இட் இஸ் ரியலி டிஃபிகல்ட் டு டாக் அபவுட் எ க்ளோஸ் ஃப்ரெண்ட் எ க்ளோஸ் காம்ரேட் ஹூ வாஸ் வித் யூ டில் எ மந்த் பிஃபோர் இட் இஸ் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி ஒன் மந்த் தட் ஷி வாஸ் கில்ட் ஐ ரிமெம்பர் ஈவன் எ மந்த் பிஃபோர் ஆன் செப்டம்பர் 5th அட் திஸ் டைம் அரௌண்ட் 7 o'clock ஷி ஹட் கால்ட் மீ வி டிஸ்கஸ்ட் அபவுட் தி ஃபைனான்சியல் டிஃபிகல்டிஸ் தட் தி மேக்சைன் வாஸ் சஃபரிங் It is difficult to even digest that such a lovely comrade who committed herself wholeheartedly to the cause of people is no more with us. That too, the way she was barbarically killed haunts you every time, haunts you every moment you are when you think of her. I came to know about this incident at 8:30 last month on September 5th. Our Lankesh Patrike's manager Mr. Raju called me telling me that Gauri's mother called him and told him that the old man residing in front of Gauri's house called her and told her that her father, her daughter has fell down and blood is coming out. So could you please go and attend her so that she is going there and she has called ambulance also. He asked me what to do. So I told him, let us rush to that place. Let's see what has happened. And I was almost some 40 minutes away from that place where she lived. And before I left the place, I just had a look at the TV. TV channels have already started showing that she has been shot. First there was one news item saying that there was an attack on her house. And within a 30 minutes, 30 seconds, there was a flash news, breaking news, saying that Gauri Lankesh has been assassinated. I could not believe that. I just started towards her house. Hundreds of phone calls started ringing. I did not want to receive the call because each one who called me wanted to confirm the incident and how could I do it. Each one wanted to know whether she is really killed and how can I really say that because I wanted to not to believe this. I refused to believe this. And I was just convincing myself that it's after all a TV news. TV anchors want some breaking news. They might have just been wrongly, might have been misled. Maybe it is. Maybe it might have not happened. But by the time I reached, Gauri's mother, Gauri's sister, Gauri's nephew were there. They were crying. Few people and already police had come. And the body was lying just in front of her house. She was hardly 5 feet tall. Very thinly structured. You can see her. Hardly an inch of thickness in her body. It was lying like an orphan. Later it was extension in Bangalore in a secluded subway. Hardly there are street lights. It is a secluded single house. There's a compound gate. She parked her car, opened the gate, and immediately two persons who were riding a bike pumped a bullet into her body. She was shot. She just ran into the house. From the gate to her house door, it takes, there are at least 10 yards. She ran and while she running, she just touched her back. There was some blood stain and she was shocked and she just turned around. Immediately, 3 more bullets were pumped into her body, 2 at the heart and 1 at her temple. Later on, I was just thinking whether it is so symbolical. One bullet was from backside. I thought it is her fellow journalist who fired that bullet. Because the fellow journalist who betrayed the very ethics of journalism, she continued. And that betrayal is that bullet. That's what I felt. She turned around, 2 bullets were pumped into her heart. I thought it is one bullet is the corporate capitalist bullet and another is Hindutva bullet. And the 4th bullet was fired at the temple. And no system in this world want a thinking brain to be alive, and the system wanted to silence that brain. I think it was a metaphorically all the four bullets had four particular meanings to myself. The next day, very next hour, hundreds of people assembled. There was a big protest in front of our house. At 12 o'clock in the midnight, there was a big, huge gathering at the center of the town. Some 200 to 300 people at the midnight, 1 o'clock, they protested against that. And the very next day, on the September 6th, thousands of people just came on their own. It was very, very spontaneous. Between September 6th to September 12th, on September 12th, as you all might be knowing, there was a huge riot. A police estimation says at least there were 25,000. You can conservatively make an estimate of 10,000. And who were those 10,000 people? They were drivers, rickshaw pullers, third gender people, farmers. I think hardly, I was just thinking, has there been any incident in this world that a journalist commands such a respect from the people? Journalist, after all, reports what happens. And I was just, after a few days, I was talking to Teesta Setalwar. I was asking her, we are friends of Gauri, maybe we exaggerate. Just tell me whether there was any incident, at least in India in the recent past, where a journalist commands such a big funeral procession. She said, absolutely, in her own lifetime, she has never seen such a big gathering showing their final respect to a journalist. I was the last in the procession. I was just thinking, what is the meaning of the death? If the death is silencing a person, if death means absolutely making a person not to respond, to my wonder, to the wonder of this world, Gauri has started speaking in thousands of voices. Thousands of voices. Gauri's magazine was not circulating in a big way. It was actually facing financial difficulties. But whatever she had to say in her lifetime, she said it in a more louder way to the whole world, 1,000 times amplified. I think this is not death. This is actually living after death. In fact, there is a big movement in Karnataka which is called Lingayat movement, which was many people referred to that. I will come to that part later. These people believe that those people who lead their life for the people, the beauty of their life is seen in their beauty of their death. I think the beauty of the death, we call in Kannada sarthakya, the final resolution of the life is seen in the death. She is not dead. That's what is the final meaning that I concluded. Friend, from September 5th, today is October 5th, from the last 1 month, thousands of pages have been written about Gauri Lankesh in all kinds of languages. I don't think any Indian language has not written about her in the last 1 month. In Karnataka, in Kannada, in Tamil, in Malayalam, in Manipuri, in Oriya, maybe not in Sanskrit. Leaving Sanskrit, I think all people's languages have written about their friend of people, Gauri. On September 6th alone, in Karnataka, there were 160 protest demonstrations, spontaneous. Karnataka has 177 talukas. Almost there was a protest in each sub-tehsil level. Between September 5th to October, today, there is a big rally happening in Delhi. You might be knowing, a national level rally. Between October 2nd and October 5th, all over India, not less than 2,000 protest demonstrations have happened. People have protested against Gauri's killing in Ethiopia, in Ukraine, in Uzbekistan, in Thailand, in Australia, in New Zealand. United Nations Human Rights Commission has condemned it. UN, United States Embassy has condemned it. It is becoming a huge. Whoever has killed, for whatever purpose, it has become very difficult for them to digest this. And to cap it all, today an international award has been declared for Gauri Lankesh in the name of Anna Polstovskaya. Anna Polstovskaya was a journalist in Russia. She consistently wrote about Putin regime's terrorism against the people of Russia, in Chechnya, in other parts of the erstwhile Russian Empire. When the whole mainstream was silent, Anna took the pen and she wrote relentlessly. For that, she was killed on October 7th, 2006. Against this, all her friends all over erstwhile Russian Empire and her counterparts in London and America together formed a group called Reaching Out Women in War, and they constituted an award in the name of Anna Polstova as an international award to be given to journalists who are writing from the conflict zones. And this time the award is given to Gauri Lankesh. Today they have declared it. There are many more in offing. Friend, it is not the award that actually gauges Gauri Lankesh's contribution to the field of not only the field of journalism, for the field of activism, for the aspiration of an egalitarian social order. I am here to talk about only three questions. Who was Gauri? Why was she killed? And who might have killed her? I just want to answer these three questions. For me, Gauri is a possibility. Gauri is a kind of assurance. Death of Gauri definitely rings a bell, a kind of the kind of situation we are living in. A threat filled, a violence filled situation waiting for the people who think like Gauri. That is one part. But Gauri is a possibility. Gauri is hope in a way. Because I have seen her journey from a very close quarters. She was not the Gauri what we are witnessing today. I first met her in 2002. She had just returned from the English journalism. She worked for Times of India. She had worked for Midday. She had covered Kargil conflict. She had worked for ETV. She had been in a sabbatical in Europe to understand the journalism there when her father died in 2000. Before understanding who was Gauri, I think a little bit background is necessary to understand, really appreciate the Gauri's contribution. I don't know how much time I have. I will try to be brief, but to talk about Gauri, it is difficult to be brief. Gauri's father was P. Lankesh. P. Lankesh was a great stalwart in Kannada literature and Kannada journalism. He was the person who started tabloid journalism, unlike the English tabloids, which were used to be a kind of yellow journalism. He started Lankesh Patrike, which inspired two generations on the values of egalitarian orders, on the values of equality, fraternity and liberty. I tell you for a fact that my generation, the whole of our generation actually were inspired by P. Lankesh through his writing, through his journalist writings and through his literary masterworks. He started his magazine in 81. 81 is the period in which Karnataka witnessed very, very progressive movements. We had Dalit movement, we had farmers movement led by Professor M.D. Nanjundaswamy, who you might be knowing, familiar with. We had language movement, which was actually against the Sanskrit domination. The whole social milieu, cultural milieu of Karnataka was reverberating with progressive aspiration. It is the time at which Lankesh started his magazine. He actually contributed to this cause. So those were the high days, actually heydays of progressivism in Karnataka. But come 90s, you had the advent of Hindutva forces, you had the advent of this liberalization, privatization, globalization, which complicated the issues, social issues. Many people, including Lankesh, for example, were unable to grasp the new situation, unable to understand the complication. For example, there was beauty pageant which was held in Bangalore in 1996. P. Lankesh could not understand the corporate motives behind it. He only said that those who are ugly, they only oppose beauty pageant. That was the liberal ethos of those days. But then when he died in 2000, Karnataka was entering into a different situation. Hindutva forces were on the rise. The liberal democratic forces were losing the steam. Left was in a total decline, both parliamentary left and the non-parliamentary left. Center itself was shifting towards the right. The liberal intelligentsia did not have the mettle to take on that, did not have the clarity to understand that. That was the time when Gauri Lankesh came to fill the void that was created by the death of her father. She and her brother, Mr. Indrajit Lankesh, together thought of continuing the heritage of Gauri, father P. Lankesh, and started continuing editing P. Lankesh Patrika. That is the first leap in Gauri's whole life. As I told you before, Gauri was an English journalist. Who were her colleagues? Some of her colleagues are editor-in-chiefs of the national English magazines. Take Times of India, Hindustan Times. All the existing editor-in-chiefs were erstwhile colleagues of Gauri Lankesh. So had she continued in English journalism, she could have been receiving lakhs of rupees as salary and she would have been living a very comfortable life. But she knew very well that that is not the purpose of her life. So in 2000, she made a decision, she made a choice. I think these are the points in anyone's life which actually describes one's character. It is the crisis, it is in the period of the crisis one's real character actually comes out. It is when the choices are there before you, when you make your willful choice to work for the people, then your character comes out. I think in 2000, she made that choice. She said that she will continue in Kannada journalism. She will continue the heritage of her father's liberal ethos. But then, as I said, the times were different. Already Hindutva forces were on the advent. In fact, like Ayodhya, like Babri Masjid in Uttar Pradesh, there is one syncretic shrine in Karnataka called Baba Budan Darga. The Hindutva forces wanted to saffronize it, wanted to liberate it as a temple. Even P. Lankesh, had he been alive, would have not gone there. Would have written one or two articles. But unlike her father, she, along with many stalwarts of the, like for example Girish Karnad, Mr. Marul Siddappa, she went there, made a thorough fact-finding and came to a conclusion that it should not be allowed to become a temple and the Darga structure should be retained. Then we, some of the progressive R nation, including the R nation which I was belonging those days, had already spearheaded an agitation to fight against this saffronization. She willingly became part of that actually organization. In 2003, when the chief minister of the then chief minister S.M. Krishna did not allow the progressive people's demonstration in the heart of Chikmagalur, many people were arrested. For example, Girish Karnad and Adantamurthy were arrested in Bangalore. Some people were arrested somewhere near Chikmagalur. Gauri Lankesh wore a burqa, took a lorry, came directly to the heart of Chikmagalur town, went rightly in front of police station and started demonstration and got court arrested. And in her lifetime, that was her first arrest in her life. That was her commitment. She was taken to custody, taken to judicial custody, taken to prison, and her one of the edition were actually published from the jail. She actually dictated all the text and that was printed. So that was her commitment. Again in 2004, when at the national level, in Andhra and in Karnataka, the ruling regime changed. And when the UPA government started saying that Naxalism is not a law and order problem, it is a socio-economic problem and we are ready to hold talks with Naxalites. And in Andhra, when Rajshekhar Reddy had come to power and had declared that Naxalites are like my brother and I am ready to talk with them. And when Naxalites in Andhra Pradesh accepted the offer to talk, along with Gauri, some of us, including me and many civil liberty activists, thought that we should use this occasion and impress upon the government and the Naxalites to see that at least Karnataka will not go the way of Andhra and Bihar, where there is a continuous bloodshed. If there is a possibility to reproach, to address the people's problem, they should be attended, they should be tried out. So then we formed a committee called Citizens Initiative for Peace. I need not say that she was again in the forefront. And we gave a call to both Naxalites and the government of Karnataka to hold talks and see that people's issues are resolved. She actually commanded such a respect from both Naxalites and the government of Karnataka. Both the parties agreed. And then she went for a fact-finding. Then the leader of the Naxalite party, then Mr. Saket Rajan, Comrade Saket Rajan, called her for a meeting. லேட்டர் ஷி ரியலைஸ் தட் காம்ரேட் சாகேத் ராஜன் வாஸ் சீனியர் டு கௌரி லங்கேஷ் இன் இந்தியன் இன்ஸ்டிடியூட் ஆஃப் மாஸ் கம்யூனிகேஷன் இன் ஜவஹர்லால் நேரு யூனிவர்சிட்டி. They were actually colleagues. Then once they mutually saw each other, there was a nostalgic feeling. And Comrade Saket Rajan made it very clear. You please talk to your government. Ask them to heed to the demands of the Adivasis. Let them not displace them. If they actually heed to the request, make us irrelevant. Once people do not need us, we will not be there. Naxalism will not be there. Go and talk to your government. So until that time, we will declare a unilateral ceasefire. She came along with the civil liberty activists, talked to the government. Government said, fine, we are ready for talks, but then betrayed, as any government does. And in 2005, February 5th, February 6th, Comrade Saket Rajan was caught and was killed in the Point Blank range. His brain was opened again. At the Point Blank range, at the highest levels, the order was given to kill him. This actually enraged everyone, including Gauri Lankesh. The whole civil liberty activists came on the streets. People actually supported them. They said that you have betrayed us. Then we tried to impress on the government, at least give the body, dead body. We want to keep it for the public view. There are thousands of people who would like to see him at the last moment. Government agreed, but police betrayed. All of a sudden, the body was taken away. There was another comrade along with Saket Rajan, Mr. Shivlingu, who was also killed. He was a Shudra and Saket Rajan was a Brahmin. The police very cunningly cremated Saket Rajan's body and buried comrade Shivlingu's body. This actually enraged again. You are practicing casteism even in the death where they defied it in their lifetime. We took the ashes of both Saket Rajan and Shivlingu and demanded justice. In the meanwhile, unfortunately, few days later, 7 constables were killed by the Naxalite for no reason, and that was actually they claimed that it is as a revenge for the murder of Saket Rajan, and the whole situation in Karnataka became topsy-turvy. Whoever was supporting the cause of civil liberty just held their hands up. They started saying that we are not related to the people. Were saying that Saket Rajan used to come to their house. You ask anyone in those days, he would say, no, Saket Rajan used to come to our house. He used to have food because he was a great scholar. He wrote 2 books, Making History, which is actually a reference book in many universities. So people took pride in saying that they knew him. But once this Pavada incident happened, everyone actually became 180 degree turn, and these people were actually targeted by the police. State conspired. And there was almost everyday threat to lives of these 3 people. One is Gauri Lankesh, another is one Professor Babaya, Nagari Babaya, and one Professor V.S. Sridhar. Professor V.S. Sridhar, who was a lecturer in a college, was attacked by ABVP gundas. And at any time, there was a possibility of these 3 people would have been targeted. This is at the public sphere. But Gauri Lankesh had to face another challenge because of this. We did not know till that day that we thought Gauri Lankesh is editor and owner along with her brother to the magazine that her father ran. But we realized that on February 18th of 2005, her brother come with a revolver at a Point Blank range, showing to her sister, says that I know you are supported by Naxalite. You are not needed to this magazine. This is my magazine. You should quit the magazine. She was just kicked out at a Point Blank range. We did not know that she was an employee there. P. Lankesh was a great man, but he was Putra Vyamohi. I don't know what you say. He was very, very, there was a discrimination. Little bit of patriarchy still remained. The assets were given to his son and not to his daughters. But then, again, there was a crisis in her life. She fought for a cause. She was targeted by the police. She was targeted by the RSS. Everywhere in those days, people were vying for her life, baying for her life. There was a threat all over. Meanwhile, within the family, there is a kind of expulsion. What kind of pressure she would have gone through? Again, there was a choice. She would have chosen the English journalism, she would have gone back. She would have actually chosen the comfort life. But she did not do that. February 18th, this incident happened. February 20th, she was alone in her chamber. Two of our comrades went there, said that we will start the magazine, another magazine. That's how her new magazine under the ownership and editorship of Gauri Lankesh came out in the style of Gauri Lankesh Patrika. This was a second leap in her life. Second time she passed the test of the life. Second time she passed the test in a remarkable way. Then onwards, the Gauri Lankesh Patrika, right from 2005 March 8th, that was the day on which the first issue of Gauri Lankesh Patrika came. I still remember those days very, very vividly, because that day was a Shivaratri day. That was a public holiday. This new magazine was released in the neck of the noon. People do not actually travel in the noon. And that was a holiday. That was a Monday. People came from all over Karnataka. All over Karnataka to just to express their solidarity to the person Gauri Lankesh, who stood with the people's cause. That was the solidarity. This new magazine came in a situation with the solidarity of the people, with the support of the people. She did not have a single computer. She had just a bare office space which was given to her by her father. Everything was brought in by different contributors. People gave their money like anything. So that is how a new Gauri Lankesh emerged. New Gauri Lankesh Patrika emerged as the voice of the people, literally of the people, by the people and for the people. Literally. Then onwards, from 2005 to the last edition, it was a weekly threat to the corporate capitalism and the fascist Hindutva forces. It was a weekly threat. Every article, every literary piece, every poetry, even the film page, every page and every sentence that was written was in the aspiration of an egalitarian social order. She exposed many scams. Many scams she exposed, including of the Congress people. She actually exposed the hypocrisy of the BJP and the RSS to the core with all documents. In the span of 17 years, or at least in the last span of 12 years of Gauri Lankesh Patrika, she took on the RSS and the BJP in a very big way in many issues. I can only narrate one or two for your information. For example, this cattle trade, when that were many Muslims were targeted in the coastal Karnataka, in the name of moral policing and in the name of illegal cattle trade, she actually documented meticulously how the police and the BJP are in hand in glove to target the Muslims and actually make the government, push the government to defense. In 2008, 28 churches were attacked in Karnataka right after the Kandamal incident. Again, she was in the forefront, both in the activism. Not only she wrote, not only she brought out booklets, books, translated books, but she was also in the forefront, because together we had founded what is known as Karnataka Communal Harmony Forum, Karnataka Komu Sauhardha Vedike. For the last 15 years, it is spearheading the movement against the communal fascism in Karnataka, which is a platform of more than 150 organizations, ranging from the ideological spectrum of Gandhiism to Nazism. There are all the people, left, liberal, people who are religious but against communal, all these people have seen the platform, and Gauri was one of the leaders of this Vedike. She led the people on the street, she wrote, she gave an intellectual backup. In 2015, on the occasion of the 10th year of Gauri Lankesh Patrika, she wrote in her editorial saying that in this period, if a journalist cannot become an activist, he cannot be a good journalist also. She said that if the truth is partisan, if the truth is one-sided, how can the reportage can be eclectical? How can the reportage be non-partisan? And if activism is truth-seeking, journalism is also truth-seeking, and you should go behind it. Go behind it. When the activism and journalism is clubbed together, then you can take any issue to its logical end. That was her motto. That was her lifestyle. That is how she lived. Till the last issue. And again, one more thing. Many of the magazines, I don't know whether that is the practice of the tabloids or the weekly magazines in கர்நாடகா, ஐ மீன் இன் தமிழ்நாடு. பட் லங்கேஷ், கௌரி லங்கேஷ் ஃபாதர் ஹேட் ஸ்டார்டட் எ நியூ கைண்ட் ஆஃப் ட்ரெடிஷன் இன் விச் ஹி ரெஃப்யூஸ்ட் அட்வர்டைஸ்மெண்ட்ஸ். ஹி வாஸ் நாட் டேக்கிங் அட்வர்டைஸ்மெண்ட். இட் வாஸ் ரன் ஒன்லி பை தி சேல்ஸ் அட் தி ஸ்டால். ஹி ரேன் இட் ஃபார் மோர் தென் 20 இயர்ஸ். கௌரி லங்கேஷ் ஆல்சோ இன்ஹெரிட்டட் தட் ஸ்ட்ராட்டஜி, இன்ஹெரிட்டட் தட் எதிக்ஸ். ஷி ரெஃப்யூஸ்ட் அட்வர்டைஸ்மெண்ட் ஃப்ரம் எனி கார்னர், ஃப்ரம் த கவர்மெண்ட் அண்ட் ஃப்ரம் தி கார்பரேட். ஷி வாண்டட் டு லீவ் ஒன்லி பை த சேல்ஸ். பட் அன்லைக் கௌரி லங்கேஷ் பத்திரிகை அண்ட் கௌரி லங்கேஷ், தேர் ஆர் ஃபியூ அதர் மேக்சின்ஸ் ஹூ ஹாவ் அதர் சோர்ஸ் ஆஃப் இன்கம். ஃபார் சம் இட் இஸ் ஏ மாஸ்க் ஃபார் தர் மாஃபியா டீல்ஸ், ஃபார் சம் இட் இஸ் ஏ மாஸ்க் ஃபார் தர் ரியல் எஸ்டேட் டீல்ஸ். ஸோ வாட் எவர் proceeds they get from other thing is finance to see that it gives a political cover. But it is only Gauri Lankesh who suffered a lot. Many tabloid magazines, because of that magazine they made money, they made assets. But it is only Gauri Lankesh who lost everything to sustain this magazine. We used to call it, it is a weekly wonder. That the Gauri Lankesh Patrike comes out every week is a weekly wonder, because it is a loss. It is a venture only filled with loss. To compensate that, she started few publications. Publications used to get money, big money. Big money in the sense, it could cross-subsidize whatever the losses Gauri Lankesh used to actually incur. But after demonetization, that November 8th disaster, all the book sales, not only Gauri Lankesh's books, all the book sales came down by 70%. It became so difficult that every month, it was difficult for her to give the salary of her staff. But unlike other esteemed institutions, it was Gauri Lankesh who used to give, pay the salary of her staff on the very first day of the month. But by February, there was no money. She sold her some of the little jewelry she had. She was writing a column to Bangalore Mirror. She used to get 6,500 rupees per column. So in a month she used to get 28,000 rupees, and as an editor she used to receive a salary of 20,000 rupees. So whatever money she got from the column writing was again poured into run this magazine. By April, it became so clear for her that she could not continue further. But we, the well-wishers, together tried to pursue her that we'll raise contribution, do something, at least for the next 2 years we should continue. We wanted to impress her on that. The last call I received from Gauri was on September 5th, night 7 o'clock. She told me that she has cleared the salary bill of her staff by the premium that she got from her LIC policy. And she said, now I don't owe money to anybody, neither anybody owes any money to me, I am financially clear. So even before her death, she has cleared all the bills and she has come. I think that is Gauri. But how was this possible? Because first time I met Gauri was in 2002. She was a urban bred, English educated, having a kind of condescending attitude towards activists, little uncomfortable with the company of the people who are not well educated, who are soily, looking soily and all that. She wanted the company of who are having name and fame, who are of class, you know. She was a party girl in that way. In 2002, when we were going for a rally, she wanted a separate hotel room for her. She did not want to share her toilet with any other activists. She was showing her uncomfort very easily and very openly. But in 2016, I am just tracing her journey. In 2016, I and she together went to a rally. A room was booked for her in IB. A rally in which women from the villages had come. There was no toilet for village women there. She came to her room. There was a Western toilet there. There was no Indian toilet. Village women do not know how to use the Western toilet. You know how it would have been used. So when another activist came to meet Gauri, she was actually with a broom, was cleaning the whole town. This is a transformation. And she was not feeling bad or anything. She was feeling very very sympathetic to that village woman, and she did not had any grounds for doing that work actually. This transformation, I think, is a possibility. This transformation and her commitment, her leaps in her life. She made a choice whenever there was a big crisis. She made a choice of choosing a conflict zone instead of a comfort zone. Here I should also say a few words about the liberal intelligentsia, the trajectory of the growth of liberal intelligentsia in Karnataka. The liberal intelligentsia is more comfortable today in Karnataka. In 1980s, when I mentioned those three big movements, Dalit movement, farmers movement and the language movement, that was actually led by the liberal intelligentsia. Those people who are stalwarts in the literature and social sciences used to sleep on the road whenever they come for a procession in Bangalore. Slowly it changed. Slowly they were co-opted into the system. Their trajectory was from conflict to comfort. And here the trajectory is from comfort to conflict. There lies Gauri Lankesh. She made a choice. I am with the people. I am with the truth. That is the moral power that she was abiding by. Whenever I look at her, I am actually amazed by the way she grew from her inside. We are activists. We read books. We get intellectual clarity. We can talk for hours about an issue. But every issue has a value embedded in it. How much that value will be inculcated in our whole thinking process is a big question as an activist to myself. How much we actually assimilate those values. Here is a woman who did not had any background of intellectuality or a kind of activism, exposed to social reality, exposes herself to the reality. There is a big struggle within her. It is not an easy process. She had to sacrifice many things. She had to sacrifice her family. She has to sacrifice her comfort. When I say her family, she was a divorcee. Her husband is, ex-husband is one Chidananda Rajagatta, who is the Washington correspondent of Times of India even today. I suggest you to read a piece written by Chidananda Rajagatta and his third wife commemorating Gauri. It is a wonderful piece. It is a wonderful tribute to Gauri. Generally what we see when there are a diverse couple there, they won't see eye to eye to each other. There is a hatred. Here there are friends. They fight on global issues. And Chidananda Rajagatta's new wife is a closest friend of Gauri, and she writes in the Times of India article that her daughters should take Gauri as their model. That is her personal life. She did not, hate was there, but hatred was only against the system which made people to suffer. She hated because she loved. There was a deep love inside her hate. And once she is committed to the core. I was just wondering, Saket Rajan was encountered. The whole state is there against us. We activists, somehow, we also get sometimes threat and we also feel sometimes fearful. But that day we lost everything and we were forcefully on the forefront. But what made Gauri to come onto the forefront? She was not a big political activist. She was not an intellectual. What made her to stand by Saket Rajan's? What made her to stand for the justice? I think that is the transformation in her inner self that happened because of her exposure to the social reality. That's why I say Gauri Lankesh in that sense is a possibility. It is a possibility which can happen to everyone and anyone if we expose ourselves with commitment. I think that gives me a large hope about the society and change. Because again on September 12th, when there was a big rally, I was just asking myself, what brought them to the streets? They were not paid people who came from villages. They paid their own money. What brought them? What dragged them there? I believe a human being is good and bad simultaneously. There is no complete absolute goodness and absolute evilness. A man is good, a woman is good and bad simultaneously. But there are some ideology or there are some activities, there are some incidences which appeals to the good sense of your psyche. There are some things which appeal to your bad sense, your evil sense. As a scholar says, socialism is nothing but organizing the goodness of the people. Fascism is organizing the evilness in the people. It is not fascism out there. Fascism is there, has a social base, has a human base in each and every one. I was asking then, what appealed to the people there? Gauri's death appealed to the goodness of the people. They thought that, no, this is wrong. Something is wrong. She should have not been killed. It is not the barbarity of the murder. It is not the barbarity of the murder. The goodness actually was appealed by the Gauri's death. There, that is where I thought Gauri is alive. That is where we should bank upon. That's why people came in a big number. Friends, I am not sure whether the culprits will be booked. I am not interested if only those two or three people who actually pulled the trigger are arrested. They may be people who are brainwashed. They may be people who might not be knowing whom they are killing also. I am not interested in that. That may not be possible also. The way the police is going with their investigation, I don't think they will reach to the logical end. The point is, four people are killed. Who is the fifth? Who is the sixth? What is the list? Who is actually giving the command to kill? Individual political assassination is the new form of violence that the Indian political scene has entered into. It is not the communal clashes alone. Communal clashes, people are getting killed. But already there is a big list. 1 week after Gauri, Bhaumik is killed in Tripura. 3 days after Gauri, one Bihar Jharkhand journalist is killed. Ravish Kumar writes to Prime Minister whether I am in the list of people going to be killed. There are 5 more journalists in the list. There are big list of people to get murdered. And who is doing that? Nathuram Godse had that metal to be there at the scene of crime and get arrested. But I don't think the victory of the morals unleashment of those era was not just in catching hold of Nathuram Godse. It made RSS to go back in the public scene for more than 25 years. They were in the defensive, politically in the defensive for more than 25 years. If not for Jayaprakash Narayan, they would have been in the exile for more time to come. I think now the time, whether the culprits are brought to books or not, that is not the main issue. The people behind, the forces behind it should be pushed to the defensive. Let us be very clear. It is these forces against whom Gauri fought for her lifetime. Gauri was killed at 8:30 in the night 1 month before. At 9:15, an editor of a Kannada daily newspaper belonging to a Brahminical subcaste which hold the bureaucracy, most of the bureaucracy and most of the judiciary belongs to, writes in his makes a Twitter saying that a Naxal sympathizer has been shot dead. And the very next day, in his magazine, he writes, left sympathizer himself might have killed Gauri. He also writes, had she not, in Kannada, Gundu has a pun. Gundu means both. Gundu means bullet. Gundu means liquor. He writes, had she not been killed by this Gundu, had she been killed by this Gundu, she would have not been become a news, at least a single column news, she would have not become. Immediately, there is a big Twitter ad saying, celebrating the death of Gauri. Why one should celebrate the death of Gauri? It's very clear. It's very clear. The constitutional morality that governed India for at least 20 years has gone to the dogs. Politics after Modi, economics after Ambani, and journalism after Arnab has completely destroyed the value system, constitutional value system of this country. Gauri Lankesh was fighting this battle of all of us. This was not her battle, it was the battle of all of us. I am told that from between 2014 May and 2017 May, 54 journalists have been killed. And what is this period? This period is when Modi came to power. 54 journalists. This is before Gauri. This is before Bhaumik. This is before that Jharkhand journalist. And in the, there is one big group called Reporters Without Borders. they come out with a statement in 2017 saying that in the index of freedom of expression, India stands at 140th position among the one community of 180 nations. It is not just intolerance. It is fascism. Fascism is not barbarity. Fascism is not just cruelty. Fascism has a mass base. Fascism make people believe which is not true. Demonetization hurts us, but Modi government make us believe that it has helped us. He is killing us. He says that I am killing you for your, in your own interest. You are being killed in your own interest, and people believe that. This is a larger battle. Gauri actually fought against these myths. She actually ran a regular column in the name of Busi Basia in Kannada. Busi Basia is a, Basia means who, one who tells always false, one who always lies. Busi means lying. That column was, she ran that column from 2013 to 2017. One Mr. Suresh Bhatt Bakrabal used to write about it. Every week there was one or other thing was to write about how he is actually conveying all falsehood and actually creating a myth. So at the end, I think this is Gauri for us. She was a very lovable lady. In a sense, you might be, if you go to her Facebook account, once Kanhaiya Kumar came to the mainstream after that great speech he delivered on February 18th, 2016, she declared that he is my son. After Una incident, Jignesh became his son. You should watch that. There is a movie, a documentary movie prepared by one Mr. Deepu of Pedestrian Pictures. It is available on the YouTube. It is called Our Gauri. You may please watch that. There Jignesh and Kanhaiya Kumar narrates their encounter with their mother Gauri. She meets Jignesh in Bangalore in a program. She says that Kanhaiya Kumar is my son and you should be my son. That's all. Come, let us have good food. Whenever you come to Bangalore, come to my house, stay here, be protected. And she used to take him to all people's movement that's going on in Karnataka. She actually worked as a bridge between different movements. So that was the motherhood that was in her. That seemingly irritant, seemingly arrogant style had that immense love actually. So what is the purpose in remembering all this? I think Gauri, even in her death, is living in a big way than she lived actually. Her voice is amplified in 1,000 ways, and we should continue that. The one thing that she said was, activist journalism and seeking truth and taking sides, these are the essence of her life. She hated, but that hatred had a deepest love. Now activists, many, I am also trained in a Marxist scholarship. We always talk of class hatredness. But class hatredness also should stem from a love towards people. Hate is not for hate's sake. As Pablo Neruda said, if you can't hate the things which should be hated to the core, you can't love the things which should be loved to the core. So that was the message of her. So I have written a small piece. It's not a poetry, but I just wanted to summarize her life. I just read that and end my speech here. A Gauri becomes the Gauri. Gauri, wanton favorer, favorite peacock feather who refused to get caught in the cap of her father. Favorite peacock feather who refused to get caught in the cap of her father. Amidst kites that did not fly, horses that did not run, you reached your destiny crawling like an ant. Amidst kites that did not fly, horses that did not run, you reached your destiny crawling like an ant. Cool, scarlet honge flower that grew out of giant banyan tree. Though abandoned by undependable worlds, you completed the journey only through your deeds. Though abandoned by undependable words, you completed journey only through your deeds. Neither obsessed with glory, nor infatuated by any sense of achievement, you continue to live an accomplished life even after your death. Outwardly hasty, but slow inside, burning yourself, you purified your inner self. Wiping out the difference between the inner and the outer, you became a Mahamane where everyone had a space. You never doused the burning truth with restrained watery words, nor wrapped the naked world with erudite drapery. Refused to label the myths of post-truth as information, wrote nothing except what you saw as you saw. Wrote nothing except what you saw as you saw. Yes, some words there, some punctuation here were not needed. Yes, some words there, some punctuation here were not needed. But would it have changed the target of the bullets? Name a fence sitter killed for following the safe middle path. Why then Gandhi, the most religious one, was also killed? You loved love, hence hated the hate. You melted, you grieved, you wept, you grew angry, you fought. You became a mother, a teacher, a word, a meaning, a purpose. Dusky, red, blue, green and white became the spectrum of the rainbow. A hope, a possibility, a symbol of immortality. You became Gauri. You became Gauri, defying the death. You became thousands of Gauri.